Welcome back. We are here at Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis, talking to Richard Paul Fink today.
Let's continue your story there.
Okay, just 2 seconds and we can go on to other things. I ended up moving to Phoenix and got hooked up with a wonderful, wonderful lady by the name of Arlen Brewster. And what she, at that time, she was both the head of the Metropolitan Opera Council, National Council, and the San Francisco had auditions. They were doing their own version of the same contests. And she had both. And she was doing a Brigadoon. And I came in on the last minute for her, did a show for her, and she said, you know, you've got a really interesting voice. And I'll help guide you. I won't be an angel. I won't pay for your way, but I will help guide you. And I think that is one of the most important things that a young singer needs, is the guidance. There was a wonderful man at HGO, she helped guide me into doing all of the opera auditions that I needed to. And so I did all of the apprentice programs around the United States. And two summers in San Francisco with the Merrill program, and a summer in Wolf Trap, and a summer in San Diego. But the culmination was 3 years with the Houston Grand Opera. Mm-hmm. And Scott Hoyman, who was David Gockley's assistant for many years, he kind of took over that role and helped guide and said, you know, this is a good role, but this one would be better. And I think it's the insecurity that a lot of singers just need to have a friend or somebody that they can feel that they can trust.
Trust and whose ear they can trust.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And it's so, so very important. And he helped guide me. Elena Nicolaidi at Houston Grand Opera was Kammersängerin with the Wiener Staatsoper, mm-hmm. a little 5-foot terror in her day, little Greek terror. But she became my voice teacher. And I think she took everything and kind of peeled off all the extra things and got down to the core and said, Richard, you know how to do all these things. Just do it. you know the tricks. Just do it. And she came out with the Nike slogan before they did. Just do it. But the stage, she loves you.
What is your first break? Break. You know, something that started your career.
The thing that got me. I don't know. I've always been the utilitarian bass baritone, and it's always been kind of the. It's been a long time coming. The work has always been hard. I always say, in the title of my book will be, a long slow slog to the top of the middle. So that basically, you know, I'm still working at it. You know, I'm still trying to get there. And I don't know that there was a moment that ever became the aha moment. It was a lot of slow doors, and like anything else, I remember 1 year there were 6 major contracts that canceled. All within, for one reason or another, financial reason. Mm-hmm. The orchestra went on strike. This part of the season was canceled, and the earthquake in San Francisco, and things just canceled. So it's always been a slow climb. It's never been that aha, you made it. We did buy me a ring the day I made my debut at the Met and said, yeah, okay, yeah, that's the Lohengrin at the Met. Oh, no, the tree, it was Lohengrin, Telramont and Lohengrin at the Met.
But speaking of a ring and climbing up a mountain, I think I hear Alberich coming.
Oh, heaven forbid.
Let's hear a little bit of the beginning of Rheingold, near the beginning, okay. From the Seattle Opera. Julian?
I love that.
Thank you, thank you. So verflucht ist die Liebe. Yeah. How many times have you sung that line?
So verflucht ist die Liebe, yeah. It's real, like you say, it's a real signature role. It's gotten to be a signature role, but it's gotten, but, you know, let the tenors do the romantic stuff, being the villain and being the nasty guy and jumping around, and I'm still, thank goodness, thank the Lord, I'm still able to do some things, put the physicality into it. In this production, I've got one moment where I literally do a full backflip off of one of the stage platforms while I'm pursuing the girls.
You mean in this the Seattle?
In the Seattle production. Mm-hmm. At another moment, the first day we got on the rock, on that big rock mountain in the middle, and it's about 10 foot tall. It comes to a point, and they said, okay, now we've made these nice little pigeon holes in the unit for you to climb up, and it's great, you know, it's cool, but we haven't figured out how you're going to get down.
That's your problem.
Yeah, that's your problem. Well, it's Richard, he'll figure it out. And so what they did was, they said, actually, the tech department pretty much left it up to me as far as how I could get down the fastest way possible. And I had a mount, a little bar on the back, and I literally do a flip off the end and drop, and so I can just disappear as quickly as possible. We were talking about all different things, but it's the Elberich, and looking at the character, it's a wonderful character because it develops so much over the course of the ring. And even over the course of just Rheingold, mm-hmm. I mean, you picture the Schmeagol Golem character, and he's just the little troll who's down at the bottom, and he's just searching for a girlfriend. He's just this guy, and that's all he really wants. And had one of those girls said yes, we wouldn't be listening to 17 hours of opera. But watching this character's transformation, and then they said, you know, I've had productions where the ring has been taken from me, where the finger's been cut off, where the hand's been cut off, where the arm has been ripped out of the socket, everything just totally disjunct, and I say, you're missing the core point. It's that drug. It's that all-consuming ring, that, and when that is taken from you, it's the moment that I've got to have that back. Right. And happens to Elberich over the course of the Siegfried and Goethe Dämmerung is the withdrawal that he goes from. Is I've got to have get it back. I've got to get it back, and it's that desire, that intensity. And the style of music changes so much from the beginning of this almost made-up Wagnerian language, garstig, glatte, glitscherige, glimmer, wie gleich die Haus, and to the curse, which finally, in some of those moments where he's talking about Valhalla and the gods, and to the beginning of Siegfried, which is actually one of the greatest moments, and in some productions, the old ring, when we just started, and you think the light just starts to come up, and is there somebody? The audience's mind says, "Is there something there, or isn't there?" Do I? And it's always the vulture just sitting on the edge, waiting for something to die, so that he can go in and get the pieces. And that's so much of the Elberich at that moment, and he's just been waiting there for an eternity. He doesn't have the plan that. That Mima does. Mima has a plan to that he's going to get Siegfried and turn him into stealing the ring for himself. But that whole...
I can see that, you know, you not only sing wonderfully and you act well.
It's the drama. And I think it's one of the greatest things I tell every single young singer I work with. Or if I don't teach voice. I will never teach voice. I'll coach. I'll work with them as an actor, but I say you have to believe in what you're saying. If you don't believe what you're saying, whether you're singing on the stage of the Metropolitan Opera or you're at your community church, they're not going to believe what you're saying. And that is so, so important. When I take a score, I will always take a score and translate. My word, German, Italian, French, Russian, Czech,
whatever,
English, you know, and this spring I'll be doing a Mozart Requiem with the St. Luke Symphony over at Carnegie. And one of the first things I did was I got the score and went through and translate every word, word for word, what I'm saying. And then with an opera score, what I'll also do is translate every word, word for word, what everyone else is saying while I'm on the stage. Because I think as an actor, you want to understand what you're saying and what's being said to you. And you've spoken foreign languages, you know that the word order is always in the different time, you know, time, manner, place, and the articles at the end, and you're trying to figure out what's going on. That's why I say first I translate every word. Then I'll do a phrase translation. Then I'll start working on the music and the notes and letting it start becoming a part of you. And the musicality has always been the gut musicality has always been a strong thing for me. You know, I think with the old musical comedy background and everything, it's always been that visceral thing for me. It's feeling it from the gut.
As an opera singer, you think acting is very important?
Personally, yeah.
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 But some are.
But here again, the difference that we face is I was trained in one medium, and I'm now trying to function in another medium, being the alive on stage, no microphones. When I first started doing the musical comedies, we didn't use the microphones. You even had to learn how to do your dialogue straight out so the back of the house heard you. And now getting into a point where we're doing everything on the microphones and with the camera, and there's nothing like, you know, having just that idea, oh my God, my face is being, you know, is how big in some movie theater, you know, being projected all over the place, but which is kind of scary.
Part of your professional time is spent in a role that's what we haven't talked about, and that is playing the role of the cover, like here at the Metropolitan Opera. That must require an adjustment up here in the head. Tell us about that.
It does. It is. I'm starting to feel more affinity with the horses in the starting gate who damage themselves, because you're always wanting to go. You're on the ready. You have to prepare yourself. As if you were going to sing,
right.
And not only daily, but the night before. You can't go out and I'm going to have go up to my favorite barbecue joint and have beer and ribs and hang out until whatever. No, you have to say, I have a performance coming up the next day. I have to be ready, be rested. It's sleep, water, good old humidifier. I will either travel with one or have a humidifier so that I can keep the humidity up. But you've got to prepare and almost warm up as though you're singing. Sometimes what helps stay in that warmed up state is what I'm trying to do right now, which is work on some other things. I've covered Falstaff many times, and I did a lot of rehearsals, but I've never actually gotten to do the role. So I'm kind of digging out the role and then singing through phrases daily. I've got this Mozart Requiem I'm working on, and then one of my dreams, I'd kind of like to do a Sweeney sometime along the line. I think it'd be fun, kind of fun. So I'm just kind of like, digging out some of those arias. I used them a while back for an audition, I figure, you know, after this last summer doing Wojciech in Santa Fe, which was the knives and the the knives were getting pretty close to my heart, so I might as well go to the next level.
Speaking of Wojciech, you've done much more contemporary pieces than Wojciech, which is another side of you getting away from the romantic heavies of the 19th century.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us about some of the really modern pieces you've done.
Well, one of my favorites that was was performed here was actually up in Portland. I got to do View from the Bridge. Oh, and I really love the Eddie Carbone role. That was wonderful. There for a long time, HGO did a new opera a year, or at least one. So I wasn't as much involved with those, but I was around them. I've been, I think the biggest ones, the biggest two keystones have been the John Adams pieces.
Nixon in China and
Dr. Atomic.
Of course.
Both at the Met. And I was quite fortunate. I was doing a ring, the ring in Seattle, and I got a call saying, would I come down to San Francisco and do the world premiere of Dr. Atomic, the Edward Teller role. So that was a lot of fun, you know, thank goodness I had a wonderful coach in Seattle who laid in the groundwork. And then when I got to San Francisco, they were very supportive and it guided me.
Is it easy for you, the contemporary music? No.
No, I have something like that. I very much have to learn by rote. And here again, I start at the very end of the piece and would start making a little sing half a sentence. I can play a little bit. I can just give myself the pitches. I'm not talented enough to give myself a lot of things. I rely on people like yourself for that. And then I would start adding and building and building and building back, and then start build those long phrases. And I think the John Adams pieces were, they really put me to another level. I've done, there was The Balcony by Jean Genet, Di Domenico, but that was years and years ago. There have been quite a few one-offs, and I think that's one of the things, even in Houston, they did A Room with a View, I'm on a recording of. There's a wonderful piece.
Who wrote the music to
A Room with a View? A Room with a View was written by... This is where the little gray cells, they are not what they used to be, come into play. Composition down at University of Houston. Bob, and I'll remember
Bob.
In about 5 minutes.
Bob, okay.
Michael Horvat wrote a wonderful piece called The Mystic Flame, which is a wonderful oratorio, an opera. And it was based around the Jewish immigration to the United States and through the trials. But I'm looking forward to some other things, Chris Theofanides. I was privy. Chris asked Sharon, my wife, and myself up to his apartment. Then he played for us the recording of the Heart of a Soldier. Mm-hmm. And then also told of his concept of another new piece that he's working on.
Heart of a Soldier is what was done very recently in San Francisco.
In San Francisco, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then also another piece, I don't know if I should mention that, but he's working on another piece that I think is going to have a real strong ramifications. But I'm all for new compositions, new works, and bending and taking the edge. Pushing the limits, but I just hope that we don't forget that it's the melodies, it's the themes and the melodies that's what has made opera great over the years, and that the connection between the melodies and as an actor, the music, the emotions. You had a wonderful gentleman on about, they were talking about Nabucco and
the chorus,
mm-hmm. And Va Pensiero would not be what it is if it weren't for that wonderful
melody,
that simple melody line. Thank goodness for some of the reality shows that I think the competition ones that show that singing can come back and that the human voice can produce some wonderful melodies, tunes, tell the stories.
So do you think modern music's sort of a lack of that, or what?
I think it's the composers. I'm going to get myself in trouble here. I think where a lot of the composers write are for their colleagues at universities, or see what I did, see what I had done. It's what's going to last the years. What's going to last the test of time? Mm-hmm. And that's where I feel I'm almost afraid of 2.5 hours of recitative. That it's, if you as a composer are done a disservice because we, the singers, have to learn that, learn the jumps, the skips, and a lot of times it's not easy. You have to do it by, or some singers have to do it by rote. Learn those intervals. It's all muscle memory, mm-hmm. muscle memory, and it takes a lot of time. The thousands of hours that I have invested in new compositions and new works to get those lines singing with the nice long bow strokes, those nice long lines, and that they'll probably never be good done again, or I'll never do them again, whatever. And that's I think so much of it. Great, go for the drama. I mean, it's old hat, but Carlyle. I think so much of Carlyle, Floyd's work, had a good, he had a talent for knowing the human voice, and or he knew, okay, this is the meat and potatoes, and if I want to touch on that high note, I'll just go up and nail that for effect, or down there for effect. The Gatsby, the Great Gatsby that we did, I had a five, there were three pages I sang, I had a full 3-octave plus range. I went from below bass below the staff to a tenor high C that I had to sing on stage. And it, you've got to know, you can scream up there in the top of your register, yeah, but then if you want me to go, oh, that's gonna come out just like that, oh, it's not gonna go to the back.
So what I hear you saying is that you have a desire for the composers of today to understand the human voice.
Yeah, yeah. Somewhere I think there's a book out there that says a violin plays these notes, a viola plays those notes, cello plays those notes, a bass plays those notes, and okay, a soprano sings these, tenor, but it's, yeah, we can sing those notes, but where do you want them to come from here? Right. And I think that's more that knowledge of the core, the middle. And here again, in Wagner, even in Richard Wagner, says, oh my gosh, how can you sing all that? Wagner is bad for young singers. And you think, I said, but Wagner writes his music like if you try to swim in the ocean, you're going to get swamped under. But if you learn how to surf the wave with Wagner, find out where in that aus der Ferne, längst vergangene Zeiten. It's totally exposed.
We're going to have to end right on that beautiful note.
I don't know how beautiful it was.
It's been a great pleasure visiting with you, Richard Paul Fink. Thank you for coming.
That was a very, very
thank
nice.
Thank you for putting up with me.
This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis.